Thank you, Ms. Gray. Ladies and gentlemen, the Hertie School of Governance has chosen an excellent time for this symposium. 2 days after the European elections, and 2 days after the elections in the Ukraine, in view of the gains of Eurosceptics, the debate about Europe can't be resumed quickly enough. We need to start campaigning for a strong and well-structured European Union again straightway. Now, at the start of the new European legislative term, it is time to think about Europe's future in the next 2 years so that we can take action soon. At the moment, everyone is interested, or seems to be interested, in appointments, who will become the next president of the European Commission, who will be members of the Commission, and so on and so on. But first, we need to answer a different question. What kind of European policies should they pursue? And this will be the best way to fight against increasing Euroscepticism and to be more convincing in our efforts to strengthen European integration. In my opinion, there are three main areas in which we need to make progress. First of all, we need to strengthen Europe's economic recovery. Second, we need to continue to develop Europe's institutions and integrate Europe more efficiently. And third, we need to maintain Europe's overall attractiveness in a world that is not hanging around waiting for us. We have already made some progress in the first of these areas, namely supporting Europe's economic recovery. The countries most affected by the crisis have started to improve their economic environment by implementing reforms. Deficits are falling, competitiveness is rising, growth is returning, assistance programs are being concluded successfully. The banking union is starting this year, and that's a huge step towards European integration, first the internal market, then the euro, and now the banking union in the form of a joint banking supervisor, followed by common resolution rules and a single resolution mechanism with a clear bail-in pecking order. Healthier, better capitalized banks will be able to fulfill their important role for the real economy more effectively and will be able to contribute to a stronger Europe and to sustainable growth. So far, the crisis has been a very intensive school of governance, so to speak. We have been given the chance to learn, to build something up, reform it, and make improvements. But it would be disastrous to think that we are out of the woods. It's important to stay aware of the crisis despite the progress we have made. The countries that have exceeded their assistance programs need to know that concluding a program does not mean the end of reforms. Debt levels are still too high. Unemployment figures, especially among young people, are still too high in many countries. Urgent reforms have not been implemented sufficiently in some important countries. Many of the jobs that have been lost in Europe cannot be brought back in their old form. Global labor markets continue to change rapidly due to globalization, technological change, and digitalization in more and more industries and service sectors. And there is a global labor supply with much lower wages and labor costs than in Europe, with qualification levels and know-how which are not that different from those in Europe. And for this reason, we need new, different jobs. Conventional government programs are not the answer. Instead, we need to create the right conditions that will generate innovations and strengthen our competitiveness. We need to maintain open and free markets. They provide powerful incentives for innovation and change. We should preserve a solid framework for competition policy in the EU. We should not fear opening up transatlantic markets with the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. This will release fresh impulses for innovation and growth. And we need to have targeted investments in research and innovation. We in Europe need to continue in our efforts. Most importantly, we need to make sure We don't hide behind monetary policy. Monetary policy is not a substitute for reforms aimed at creating sustainable growth. On the contrary, there is a danger that monetary policy could weaken the willingness of policymakers to undertake reforms. We also need to be very careful that our efforts to boost liquidity and improve the supply of credit do not create new bubbles and ultimately lead to new crises. High levels of liquidity create the wrong incentives and distort price structures. In that kind of atmosphere, there is a danger of irresponsible and reckless investment decisions. I fear that there is a high risk of this at the moment. I'm also concerned about claims that the euro is too strong. Here, too, we need to heed Friedrich August von Hayek's warning against the pretense of knowledge. No one knows the correct exchange rate would be. A competition to achieve the weakest currency would be disastrous. If the ECB's independence and the limits on its mandate didn't already exist, we would have to invent them at a time when the ECB is expected to solve too many problems. These are extraordinary times for our monetary policy. They should remain extraordinary and they should come to an end soon. My second point is about developing Europe's institutions and making European integration more efficient. The crisis in Ukraine shows that this is not just about economics. Europe's common foreign and security policy needs to become stronger, and more importantly, Europe needs to make this policy more visible. At the same time, the Ukraine crisis once again underlines the importance of economic factors. If we want to continue to rely on the tools that we believe will be successful in the long term, by which I mean diplomatic and economic instruments, then it is all the more important for us to be strong. In recent years, we have strengthened the monetary union, we have improved institutions and created new ones, we have established stricter rules on sustainable fiscal and economic policy, and we have introduced better supervision over budgets and economic policy in individual countries. Now we face the situation that the Lisbon Treaty reflects the European reality of 2014 only to a limited extent. We have significantly deepened European integration, but not always using the community method, which is the approach that I would always prefer in principle. But when we are unable to solve urgent problems with the European treaties in the current form, we often had to fall back on the intergovernmental approach in order to reach a swift solution. For example, as part of the banking union, we had to choose an intergovernmental construction for the creation of the European Bank Resolution Fund, which will be financed by contribution from banks. Under the current treaties, the EU is not allowed to collect banking levies or taxes. And it was not possible to achieve a totally convincing separation of supervision and monetary policy in the European banking supervision mechanism. We also had to adopt the fiscal compact, with its obligation to introduce national debt breaks in the form of an international treaty. This intergovernmental approach is only second best, but it's better than nothing. But in the long term, second best is not good enough for Europe. We will gradually have to replace or supplement these second best solutions with limited changes to the treaties. Some of these changes will reflect the new reality of the Eurozone. But we need to be very careful to leave the door wide, wide open for member states which have not yet introduced the euro. There are some things we can do directly without treaty change. For example, we need a more effective Eurogroup. To do this, we could amend the Protocol number 14, and that was concluded alongside the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, and which governs the work of the Eurogroup. The first step can be taken without a real treaty change or with only limited changes. We need a more efficient European Commission. Many procedures could benefit from being tightened. I'm also in favor of the idea of giving a limited number of Commission vice presidents overall responsibility over combined areas, with the remaining commissioners reporting to them on their portfolios. That is an example you have in a lot of governments, for example, in the actual France government as well, which is maybe the best example for an efficient government. I also can imagine there being a Eurozone Parliament. The European Parliament should be involved more effectively in Eurozone decisions. I also think it would be possible for us to use the EU budget as an instrument for setting priorities in individual member states. We could support the EU's country-specific recommendations through a targeted and conditional use of resources. In this way, we could fight problems in individual countries and support structural reforms. The question, do we want more or less Europe, is misleading if it puts in this form as an alternative. On the one hand, we need a stronger Europe, particularly when it comes to major questions and cross-border issues that countries cannot deal with on their own. On the other hand, we need a greater willingness to apply the subsidiarity principle consistently. Unfortunately, people often pay lip service to this principle without really taking it at heart. Responsibilities need to be more clearly attributed to the appropriate levels. As many competences as possible need to remain decentralized and in the hands of local authorities, regions, and member states. But those things that can only be decided on the European level need to be decided by European institutions. For example, I could imagine having a European budget commissioner who would be able to reject national budgets if they don't correspond to the rules we have jointly agreed. We have a similar arrangement to make sure that countries stick to the rules in the form of the competition commissioner, and it has been very successful. This new proposal would not violate budgetary law, because the question of how the rules are complied with, whether by means of lower spending or higher taxes, remains the responsibility of member states. Insisting that countries comply with the rules that we have agreed in Europe does not violate national sovereignty. Otherwise, we shouldn't agree on any rules in Europe at all. The EU could mainly focus on ensuring a fair and open international market and concentrate its policy action on trade, financial markets, currency issues, climate, environment, and energy, as well as foreign policy and security policy. In other words, on these areas where only the European level can successfully take long-term action. This way we could achieve a real added value for the European project. And if we limit our work on the European level to these major high-level tasks, it would create additional legitimacy. Each level in Europe should have the legislative and implementation powers for its competences. We don't need a European administration across the whole continent to achieve this. It would be enough if the decisions that have been made on the European level were implemented properly and fully. This would mean, however, that we would also need better democratic legitimization for the European institutions. This is why I have repeatedly suggested the idea of directly electing the Commission President. We have now achieved the first step, and I think it has been rather successful, maybe more successful, more efficient than some of heads of states and government have expected in advance, but it will work, I am quite sure. But I think a direct election of a European president of the Commission all over Europe would change European communication situation in a very efficient way. For me, the goal is to have a European legislative, executive, and judiciary branches that clearly legitimized by the citizens of Europe. In this process, of course, we in Germany will have, everyone in Germany will have to accept that when it comes to decisions that are made on the European level, it's of course the European Court of Justice that is ultimately responsible for settled disputes and not national courts. In terms of the European Parliament, we need a uniform and European electoral law. And the composition of the Parliament must be based on the principle that all votes are equal. The Parliament represents Europeans as citizens of the EU. I don't believe that anyone in Europe wants a centralized superstate. And I also don't believe that the majority of people are willing to give up their nations. In any case, that isn't necessary. The issue is much more about having a system of competences that is suitable for tackling global problems, with also following the principle of subsidiarity. The things that nation states, regions, and local authorities can administer themselves should remain their responsibility. But once we have clearly divided up the responsibilities, then each level should have proper democratic legitimization for the task, for its tasks. Then each level would take care of those things that can best be tackled on that level. I'm not so keen on the terms that normally used in the political debate for a future European system. Political union is a very vague expression. United States of Europe is something we could in some loose sense already call ourselves today, but this expression is again too vague to capture the special character of the European system, and it can lead to misunderstanding if it makes you think of the United States of America. If you want to describe in a more technical way, I think we would then be a multi-level democracy, not a federal state whose centers of gravity would lie in the middle of a political structure that is almost like a nation state. But at the same time, it should be much more than a confederation of states whose connections remain weak and lacking in legitimization. Instead, it should be a complementary and interconnected system of democracies with different scopes and competences. So far, something like a system of double democracies that is both national and European. We would then be citizens of our national democracies and of European democracy at the same time. We could give this idea concrete form by giving citizens two passports, but not the right to vote twice in one election, of course. That is a different thing. In this way, we would improve the quality of integration within Europe. People's mistrust in overly complicated EU structures could be transformed into pride. Pride in being citizens of a Europe that is democratic on many levels. There are plenty of reasons to be proud of Europe. A 2012 study by the European Union Institute for Security Studies shows that the EU members are considered to have the largest amount of soft power in the world. This is because of Europe's attractive culture, its well-educated populations, vibrant civil societies, an open and democratic political culture, the social market economy, international successful companies, a model of government that successfully combines national sovereignty with pluralism and a diverse range of decentralized relationships, not to mention our experience with integration or our multilateral cooperation and our value-based foreign policy. All these things are seen as part of Europe's soft power and a part of the European model. And we must preserve the attractiveness of the European model in a world that is not changing around waiting for us. This is my third point today. This is no easy task. Because on the other hand, we Europeans have a reputation of being rich, aging, and risk-averse in a globalized world that is becoming more and more competitive. We have a great need for security. We have high levels of social benefits, challenging demographic trends, and low levels of raw materials and energy reserves. And when it comes to new technologies, we are often as risk-averse as Herman Melville's hero Bartleby, who always said, "I would prefer not to." For this reason, the fundamental question is, will the Western democracies and our free market system continue to function as a global role model? Our model is competing with other systems, which have in the meantime also become very successful economically, but which are far less democratic and which are not sustainable from a social or ecological perspective. More than other regions, we Europeans are at great danger of falling behind in the international rankings. The financial and economic crisis and the sovereign debt crisis mainly affected the Western industrialized nations. They led to massive economic downturns. As a result, the European economy as a whole has stagnated over the past 6 years, despite the recent recovery. Other regions have experienced rapid growth during the same period. Europe's shares of global patent registrations has fallen by almost half over the last decade. In this global competition, Europe will only be able to survive if it acts as a whole, and if we can only do this if we constantly work to improve ourselves, if we constantly work on our political structures and our competitiveness. For the sake of our unique characteristics, Europe must always be a bit better, a bit more stable, and a bit more attractive than other regions of the world. The key thing is to demonstrate the success of our European model in the future too, so that we can maintain our special European characteristics, which are the things that make us attractive. It's essential that we play our part in tackling global sustainability challenges, and we have to help create new international systems that are based on European or Western values. Today, the world is looking for new forms of governance. It's looking to further develop the nation-state system. No nation-state can solve the major problems and challenges of our time by itself. The sovereignty principles, which has been developed since the Peace of Westphalia, does not guarantee enough stability. National regulatory monopolies and bans on intervention are no longer enough in our globally independent world. That applies to the internet as much as it does to the economy and the financial markets. It also applies to human rights and to peace and stability. In this search for political and economic cooperation, which complement the nation state system and which can balance out the shortcomings of the system, Europe is well placed to help. Many people outside of Europe, in particular, see us as an attractive model for global governance in the 21st century. And we self have to understand that in time of the Ukraine crisis and in the aftermath of the European election, it's decisive to strengthen European integration and to strengthen European structures is the best reaction on both, on the result of the European election and on the crisis in the Ukraine. You, the students of the Hertie School of Governance, are learning to help build up a Europe with good governance. In this respect, it's particular for selfish reasons that I warmly congratulate the Hertie School of Governance on this 10 years anniversary and wish you continued success in your important work. Thank you very much.
Questions, so I will now ask for questions from the audience, and with all respect and affection for my colleagues in the media, I am going to try to take questions from other guests and students first before we come to media. Professor Endemann, we need a microphone up here, please. And do please tell us who you are when you pose your question, and single questions if you would, please.
Henrik Enderlein, but I will violate the second condition, Melinda. One first question is, you mentioned liquidity risk in the euro, or you mentioned liquidity risk and the high risk, as you put it, of an asset price bubble. Were you thinking about Germany or the entire euro area? Because I was struck, you said this in the section on the ECB, and the ECB obviously is in charge of the euro area, not Germany. The second question is very brief. You mentioned Protocol 14 treaty reform. What's your time horizon for this reform? Because it requires ratification in all EU member states.
My remarks on the danger of too much liquidity was not related on Germany, but on the whole Europe, and by the way, on the global economy as well. For example, if you take the figure of the percentage of total indebtedness of all industrialized countries in relation to the to the national growth project of all industrial countries. We had, of course, the highest level in this relation at the end of World War II. Actually, we have achieved the same level as at the end of World War II. If you look what's going on in financial markets, the last couple of years we had uncertainty and the risk of the Eurozone as a major concern of all international financial markets and so on. Any global meeting was relied on the Euro crisis. And everyone was an expert in solving European problems, by the way. Now we have the opposite. Our financial markets are under the problem that there is a lot of influence of liquidity from the emerging countries in the last couple of years, which creates other problems. Therefore, we ever know the interest rate. Of course, I don't never make any recommendation for monetary policies. It's much better in the hand of the central bank, and they are well much better prepared. But it's Mario Draghi himself who is saying again and again and again, and it was the same with Jean-Claude Trichet and all the other heads of central banks. Monetary policy must not replace the decisions that have been taken in fiscal policy and in structural reforms by political decision makers. You must not, they cannot replace. And by the way, in the last report of the German Council on Economic Advisors in the end of last year, this report describes the risk that a misunderstanding of the means by monetary policy could lead to weakening the decisiveness in implementing structural reforms. Yeah, we have always to have in mind that we don't rely on on the wrong incentives. Having said this, of course, it's a difficult way, and it is always the main subject in any global discussion, for example, in the G20 framework. How can the central bankers take the decision to reduce too much liquidity? You know, it's a main task of Federal Reserve and so on and so on. In Germany, we are in a rather specific situation, as you know. It's one of the problems of the Eurozone as well. Therefore, our basic understanding of saving and defending the euro in the last 4 years has been, of course, implement a more solid fiscal policy in any member state concerned, but as well, structural reforms to regain competitiveness. And if you look at the figures, we have done rather well. The average deficit of all Eurozone member states have halved in the last 3 years. And the shift in the competitiveness between the most competitive and the less competitive countries has also halved in the last couple of years. It's not done, but we are on the right way. That's what we have to do. So what's the time table for treaty change? Oh, look. If you... some days ago, I had joined a meeting of historians, professors of history. And they told me, as a professor of history, you become pessimistic. I said, as a politician, you must not be pessimistic. You have to be optimistic. If you have asked me for a plan for German reunification in the second half of the 80s of the last century, I would have said, I don't know. I don't know whether I will be alive when it will happen. Then it happened. We have to make pressure. Maybe it's always the same, especially a society like Germany. It's quite interesting, by the way. The most efficient member states in the OECD in implementing structural reforms, Mario Monti knows this very well, on behalf of the last report of the OECD, are the member states under the European program, the reform programs, because they have been obliged to implement reforms. Germany is not the best doing country actually in implementing reform. As long as you have a relative well-doing situation, you defend what you have, and you don't like reforms. That is always difficult, but we have to have in mind that the world is not waiting on Europe. Therefore, we have to remain efficient. Therefore, maybe it will it will take time. I know if you study the problem theoretically, you will never get any treaty change. I bet we will have. We will get some. I bet we will get some, and therefore we have to prepare. But as having said this, I would like to add, I am always thinking in two ways. The one way is the way I would like the direction we should have to go. And the other thing you have also to have in mind, sometimes I am criticized by philosophers and so, that I are too realistic, too pragmatic. Of course, as long as I have no alternative, I have to solve problems with the instruments we have. And we did it rather successfully in the last couple of years.
Thank you very much. My name is Martin Lidegaard. I'm the foreign minister of Denmark. Good to meet you.
With all the respect, I always say I'm an admirer of any foreign minister.
I'm taking floor because, Minister, you mentioned one of the areas where you could see EU playing a bigger role and maybe a very important part of our soft power, which I agree completely with the concept, would be the energy field. But you mentioned it very briefly. Yeah. And I think that the Ukraine crisis has shown us that the energy policy of Europe has become not only a question about climate, not only a question about our industry's capability of competing in the future, but also a question about energy security. And I think that we might agree that the single most important thing to happen now for your energy vendor, for our flexibility and pricing, will be to actually have the single market of energy functioning. And I think that Germany plays a vital role, and I think your ministry plays a vital role in making that happen. We have been discussing this for decades, and we are still rather far from a real liberalization of the energy markets of Europe. Will you take a front lead in that?
I agree, but I have to say, not as an excuse, I am not the responsible minister in my government for energy issues. And I would not, I didn't like to torture for longer than 30 minutes with my English lecture. That would be really not very polite to you. Therefore, I did not care on energy policy, but I agree 100%. I think, and we are doing in the new government with Sigmar Gabriel as responsible minister for economy, I think we have increased some problems. It's not done. We have to do a lot of things. I think Commissioner Oettinger is on the right track. He's doing very efficiently. But it's a long way to go. And you know, we all know, that of course in the short term, if we stick to the truth, we have to have in mind that we can some of our member states in the EU will suffer a lot of problems if the confrontation with Russia would be without any limitations. It's okay. Therefore, we have to work that we reduce our dependency on this. But it must end, and I think we should stick on it. I am in favor of an European common energy policy and a common European energy market. And by the way, but now I have to be careful, because I am always in temptation to say something publicly which will create some major issues in the daily political discussion in Germany. I'm totally convinced that we cannot solve problems in Europe in saying everything has to be decided on the German level. That is in energy politics not doable. In data protection, by the way, we are not the only one. And I mentioned the transatlantic trade and investment agreement. If we Europeans will not be ready to negotiate with the Americans on a common level, if we make only free trade agreements with parts of Latin America or Asia, it's not really convincing. Therefore, we have to be so that it means that we must be ready always to amend our standards of living. But it's saying that is dangerous for a member of government in Germany. Therefore, don't quote me, please.
Thank you very much. Could I have the microphone for Senator Martin, please?
I would like to follow up on the point made by the Danish foreign minister, who mentioned the single market for energy. Do you feel Mr. Federal Minister, that if we take into account the particular state of mind and political convulsions of the UK in relation to its membership of the European Union in the future, do you feel that starting maybe with the energy issue, but more broadly, there could be a new round of intensive, serious work done by the member states in order to bring the single market up to what we need, in particular within the Eurozone? Because the paradox is that sometimes we find a greater compliance with the single market rules and principles in member states of the European Union, which are not member states of the Eurozone, whereas we would need within the Eurozone an even more perfect single market. Do you see this to once again as something that could capture the attention of policymakers in the months and years to come?
Thank you, Senator. As you know, and as we all know, you know much better all the problems of the internal market and to improve the internal market and also regulations. You are the most experienced expert on all this, and you have so many. Ask me. As I'm very supportive. You mentioned the specific problem of UK, and also what is indeed truth. We have sometimes in the Eurozone we have more regulations than outside of the Eurozone. Therefore, my first remark on this: first, it's true. I agree. Having said this, it's my best argument to try to convince UK not to leave the European Union. It would be much better if UK would join the Eurozone. That would be much better. But it's a long way to convince them. Maybe we get some treaty change before we will have this. But the better we will deliver results in the Eurozone, the more likely is that UK will think about its own decision. We have always to respect their decision. Having said this, in the Eurozone, we have to have in mind when we, I'm convinced that we need more integration in the Eurozone, because to make our common currency stable, we are condemned to increase our integration. Otherwise, it will not work in fiscal and in economic policy as well. Having said this, sometimes we tend too much on, we stick too much on regulation and not on free market. That's the opposite. We want better integration, and we tend to do much regulation, which is not in the end. And then we are defending everyone on its national interests. And the supporters of more markets, market solutions are partly stronger in the non-Eurozone member states, like Denmark, like Sweden, like not only you, to mention UK. And therefore, when we suffered all our discussions on creating the banking union, which is, by the way, for all not professionals in European affairs, the banking union is in some partly a matter of the Eurozone and partly a matter of the common market. Therefore, we had to find solutions as well in the Eurogroup as in the ECOFIN. And that is a more fascinating challenge to get decisions in the European. By the way, we did it. And at the end, we had to convince the European Parliament that we had. And this is always what I mentioned with the second best solutions. It's a difficult job. So, having said this, when we, in the beginning of a new period, and I think this European election on Sunday has given a lot of incentive for everyone to think about what can we do better. We have, of course, the situation is Italy has a surprising good result in some remarks. Germany is rather, blah, 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 so it works, so more or less. France is, oh, yeah. No. And it's a lot, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's for everyone in Europe. Not only for our friends in France. We have to have in mind what mistakes have we made? That a quarter of the electors voted for a absolute, not a right-wing party, but for a fascist extremist party. That is a disaster. And when I got the poll in Le Monde 2 weeks ago, in which it was, if I'm right, only 39% of the French population were in favor of staying in the European Union. Maybe the percentage of supporters in UK is higher than in France. And it's France. Without Italy, it's not possible. Without France, it's not possible. It's not only a matter for the French politicians. It's a matter for all of us in Europe to care and to take serious what happened. But by the way, a participation rate in European elections in Slovakia of about 17 or 18% is always a shame. Therefore, it's a lot of incentives we have to care. But my conviction is we have to make Europe better, not to become Eurosceptics and to say, yes, of course, people don't want. If you look what's going on in the globalized world, imagine European integration would not work. We will not be able to pay any contribution to stabilize this global world. Therefore, we have to stick. And of course, in the history of European integration, any task to start with a political union has failed. It was in the beginning of the early 50s in the French National Assembly when the European Defense Community, which was, by the way, a political union, failed. It was in the late 80s when Jacques Delors made the proposal for a European currency, and we had, of course, the discussion whether we should start with a European currency together with a political union, which, of course, for any economist would have the better solution, a political union for a common currency. But if we would have waited until we get it, we would never get it. Therefore, we have to go step by step and then to use the next crisis to implement the next step of integration. That's the only way in which Europe has worked, and I think we have to go on there. But we should use this incentive of this message of this European election. We have to take it serious, and so I hope. Crises are always chances. We are in a crisis, good chances.
Minister Schäuble, when you talked about what governance is needed in Europe, by the way, I'm Tanja Börzel, Freie Universität Berlin, you said we should not so much focus on the question whether more or less Europe, we should debate policies. So I was wondering whether you could say a little bit about where you see the main cleavages in Europe with regard to future policies in the EU, and particularly with regard to the Eurozone. On the one hand, between the two major parties in the European Parliament, the Social Democrats and the European People's Party, which from the election campaign, I wasn't quite sure whether there were any differences. And maybe, on the other hand, something you can say more about, between France and Germany, between the two governments. So where do you see that the French government positions differs from the current German government's position with regard to governance in the European Union?
If I would answer your second question, I would begin a mistake. Because a German minister does never comment French policy in a different way to say we trust France and we are best friend, blah, 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 blah. And then we have, of course, we are now, it makes no, it, the result would be only worse. Of course, we are, I had a lot of contacts in the last couple of hours and days with a lot of French colleagues and friends, and everyone is concerned and aware, and we think about what can be done, what can we do, blah blah blah. So, in the relation of the European policy, of course, the problem in this campaign has been that for public opinion, it was a matter where you are pro-European or you are skeptic. And as long as this is a major issue in a campaign, then of course there is not to be seen the difference in substance. Of course, I would always say, I can explain you why conservative parties in Germany, Christian democracy, are much better than social democratic parties, not to be compared. But of course, we are in a coalition, therefore it's my best friend, and so it works on. But no, I think we have a better understanding. In the last couple of years, we had discussions and some very important personalities and dear friends as well in the room and they had to suffer with the stupidity of the German finance minister in the last couple of years, when I said, since we have agreed on rules, we should try to stick to the rules. Because we have always to convince constituencies that this way is right. I was in the German debate in the last couple of years. The first 2 years, I was seen, even in my own party, as a too romantic, pro-European from last century. By the way, it's nonsense. I want to have an efficient Europe. Then we have seen, Europe is becoming too much German. What is, by the way, allow me, also nonsense. What we want to have and what we want to achieve is a strong Europe, a Europe which will be strong enough to remain relevant in the global dimension. And that is not done. That's not granted. As I have said, we are rich, aging, and risk-averse. Our expenditures in Europe, it's average. The European average for social purposes in relation to national gross product is double compared with other industrialized regions of the world. That has to be financed and achieved in a competitive world. That's not true. We have a very specific demography. And of course, when you have a new technology like, say, as fracking, not only in Germany, the first reaction is, we must have a regulation to forbid. In America and other parts of the world, there's a new chance, a new opportunity. That makes some differences. Of course, we have, in Europe, we have, for example, if you look at the banking sector and the financial sector, we have a different tradition and culture in continental Europe in relation to the Anglo-Saxonian world. So I rely on capital markets in financing. We rely on banks. It's totally different. Of course, we have to find, until now, we have not achieved to get common rules for, give me the word, was ist Rechnungslegung? Account, for accounting. We have no common rules for accounting. If I discuss with German banks that they have to raise capital to achieve the American level, they explain me, they have different rules on accounting. You can't compare. We don't get it. We work for this in the London Institute for decades. We don't get it. And I bet if you look, data protection, and even, by the way, even NSA, the most problem is not intelligence service. The most problem is we have a new technology with unbelievable chances and dangers. And we have to care on this. It's a Western discussion. If we want to stick to our values, we have to think about how we can stick to these values in this time of internet and so on. To think everyone is allowed to use his data, any company. It is the most best criterion. We have the best capitalized figures in data collecting. The only institution which is not allowed to use data are intelligence service. Then we should not spend any cent for intelligence services. It makes no sense. Therefore, but we don't care on this. And what is even more important is we are not relevant enough to convince our American friends to discuss this with others seriously. I'm still convinced that the United States are the indispensable nation, not at least for the US Europeans. If you ask members, our colleagues from the Baltic states or from the Eastern, they tell you, yeah, it's better to be ally of the United States of America. It's even more worse than be only ally from Denmark and Germany. But as long as our American friends don't understand that reciprocity is a precondition for global soft power, as long as they will have their problem for us. By soft power, America cannot compete with Europe. We are much better. But they have more hard power. Therefore, we have to bind European soft power with American hard power. That means we should remain more relevant, even to help our American friends to deliver better results. But this is a major task as well. So.
Yes, actually, neither foreign minister nor senator, just a student here from the Hertha School. My name is Mirko Hohmann. Minister Schäuble, we are here to discuss a political crisis, but I think we can agree that the political crisis was caused by a financial crisis almost or more than half a decade ago. And if we look at history, it's inevitable to say that these economic crises repeat themselves. Nevertheless, I think we seem not to be learning from them in the sense that we don't take them into account for the future. And if we look at the predictions, how Germany is supposed to grow, it's going upwards all the time in regarding the predictions. And we're not taking into account that there will be another crisis. And so I'm just worried that we forget the tremendous negative impact that the future crisis could have on Europe. And my question for you is how we could start to take it into account. And the second, maybe more personal question would be to you. You've been finance minister for 5 years now, and you said we only do reforms when we're actually in crisis. And how far would you say that your job might have been even easier 5 years ago, because that was when we were under much more pressure than maybe we are now? Thank you.
First of all, in the sense of lifelong learning, we are all students. And I think it's very important that we all feel ourselves as students, because we have to learn, and even in times of crisis. I am quite convinced, all of myself, I try to learn. And I think all my colleagues have learned in the last couple of years a lot of things in regard with this crisis. And I think we have taken some lessons, but as soon as you have achieved some progress, the decisiveness begins to be weakened. That's complacency. That's always the thing. That even in the euro crisis, that's why I said, oh, we have achieved a lot of success. You have to explain this, because otherwise everyone said, it makes no sense. It was all night. It was the right thing. But we have to stick on the way. We have to stick on the way. Of course, the job of finance minister, you are right, I agree, is much easier in times when you have major crises. Then everyone is under pressure and they have to compete. My predecessor, and he, by the way, he had Steinbrück had was finance minister in this time when Lehman Brothers happened, and that I am happy that he had to take the job with Chancellor Merkel at that time. He wrote a book on his 4 years as finance minister. And when we started in 2005 in this government, the first Merkel government, I was Minister of Home Affairs in that government. We started with the European deficit procedure against Germany, because in 2003, Germany, together with France, it's a pity to say, but it's a shame, it's true. Ayamonte has often reminded us, you have been the first who violated the European the European regulations and rules. And there we were submitted to a European deficit procedure. And the first decision we take in the Merkel government in late 2005 was to tell the European Commission, we accept this deficit procedure, and we will comply, and we will not take any action against this deficit procedure. But we promise that we will comply. And what is rather certain, we delivered what we promised. But 2 years later, as we have been rather successful even in this 4 years, and he wrote this in his book himself, if I quote only my predecessor, he wrote, as soon as we have made some progress, the decisiveness of all the other people in our coalition and to take decisions in a parliamentary government, you need the support of majority in parliament. And this support has been weakened. It's always the same. I have been rather successful in reducing our deficit in federal budget from 2010. And I remain committed to deliver, to stick to this, because maybe we have seen that in last general election, this fiscal policy have been one of the key reasons that we did so well, and that is the reason I can continue in this way a little bit. I don't know how long, we will see. We will see what will happen. But now we always have to take. And I remember very well in the late 90s and in the first years of the new century, everyone in Germany, I think beyond as well, we said, the less regulation you have in financial markets, the better it is for financial industry. In 2007, we had no regulation. And what happened? Markets destroyed themselves. That is, you can't have sustainable order of freedom without regulation. You need some borders. That is the story of democracy. A stable democracy requests some. Actually, we don't care on security. Stupid, old-fashioned, blah, 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 blah. We are the data protection here. Yeah. I bet as soon as we will suffer some major terrorist attacks, a lot of people will say, oh, these crazy political leaders who didn't care on security. And you can study in other parts of the world, not only in the Ukraine. As soon as a political order cannot prevent the absence of violence, this political order will not be sustainable. This is the first demand from people to live safe. Of course, it's not sufficient. To live safe is not sufficient. In a Brussels, you can't live safe, but it's not the way. But it's a precondition, and therefore we have only to find the right balance, and that is what we have to take care of. If we want, and that's my reasoning, if we want to stick to our European model, and I think Europe is so fascinating, I don't know any better model in the world. Then we have to care, and we have to be reliable and competitive. Otherwise, we will fail. And that would be a pity for the rest of the world, because they would miss this wonderful model. For this way, Denmark should join the Eurozone as soon as possible.
Minister, one last question. If you'll put your hand up, please. Then we have one right here to this young man.
Thank you very much. You just said that the world has become more and more competitive. And my question is, do you think the European Union is a driver or a victim of globalization? And how does this fit into the current negotiation regarding the free trading bloc between the European Union and the United States?
Okay. We are always both driver and victim. That's quite normal. But we are more driver than victim. If you look at the way, at the level in which you live, the way of life, the standard of life. If you look where you get all the goods you use, if you look where you get the information all you use, if you look where you are traveling, if you look where you will work in your future, in your professional future. In my I have been born in 42. I grew up in the years after World War II. I grew up in the Black Forest, close to the French border. But even a journey to France in these years was a difficult challenge in the first years, and an adventure. And doing skiing in the Alps was you couldn't imagine. If you ask a young girl or a boy with 14 years who is skiing, and you ask him where have you spent your last holiday, I think, oh, again in the Alp valleys. Oh, it's so boring. And I would like to travel next time in the Caribbean Sea or something else. The level of life we enjoy. Of course, we are not happy because everything which is everyone has is not make us happy. Only when we have a differentiation to others, it's a sort of happiness. Otherwise, we are maybe confident, but not more. No. But we are driver of the globalization, and therefore we have a responsibility to make the globalization in a way which is sustainable for the future of life in this globalized world. We cannot say, oh, it's up to China, it's up to India to solve the problem. It's also our own responsibility, of course, because others are saying, as soon as we have achieved a similar standard compared to the Europeans, then we can care on this, as long as we don't criticize us. That is one of our problems. Therefore, to answer your question, we are driver, more than victims.